All right, we've just seen this amazing video that shows us what AI means to people. And it means different things to different people, depending on their roles and their backgrounds. And I'm actually wondering, Frans, what does AI mean to you? And also, what challenges do you think it can solve in the future?
Well, I'm not sure that we fully know yet what it means to us. Right? That's the honest CEO assessment. But we all know that it is important. At the same time, the origins of AI lay many years behind us. And as Mark van Buchem pointed out, you know, where are we on that hype curve? Philips has decided that AI is going to be pervasive in all we do. And therefore, we are embracing it. Therefore, we are shifting Philips from a product company to a solutions company, where we bet deeply and heavily on informatics as an enabler for, you know, delivering on the quadruple aim of healthcare: outcomes, productivity, patient experience, and staff experience. But you heard in the video, many people say, you know, it is pervasive, it's adaptive, it needs to be part of the solution, it is not a standalone miracle, you know, potion that suddenly makes you better. And so we are all, I think, discovering how to do this best. And we have great examples, and then it scales, and we have examples where it doesn't scale yet, right? And of course, as a businessman, in the end, you want your innovations to scale. We heard Mark van Buchem talk about, you know, that some of the research he did, it still is not in the clinical setting, right? So I think we all the time need to think about, oh, this is so cool, yes, but will it scale? Will it really, in a large volume, help people?
And what are typical, if I may ask, what do you see scale and what do you see not scale? Is there elements that you can recognize there, or?
Well, where AI for us is already scaling is in interpreting clinical data in intensive care, where we interpret a constant flow of data from multiple sensor devices, and we are able to correlate that data, compare it to normal baselines, and then we can be predictive what is going to happen with that patient in the future. Right? This is a real-life application where, through predictive analytics, we can say this patient may actually get, you know, cardiac arrest. Mm. Oh, by the way, this patient is going to get sepsis. Now, that is really beneficial. And it takes the stress off the staff. It is better for the patients, better outcomes. You know, ICU patients that stay longer just cost a lot of money. So it's a fantastic example that really works.
Yeah.
In the area of radiology, where, you know, much of the presentation was, we see successful application of AI in the area of productivity. Perhaps people would have expected, you know, already algorithms routinely interpreting images. That's not yet scaling. But Performance Bridge, as a platform to gather data on how a radiology department works, finding out the inefficiencies, better able to schedule, finding lost revenue opportunities, avoiding dual image acquisition, right, by doing a first-time right acquisition, looking at the variance between people. That kind of actually is more robotic process automation than true AI, if I may say so. Maybe I'm stepping on somebody's toes now. But, you know, like we apply robotic process automation within our own company, I would say this is the equivalent for the radiology department. And this is immediately applicable. It works. It scales. Even though, you know, you can ask then the question, do we have the right salespeople to convey the benefits to the market, to the customers, and can they ramp this up everywhere? Right? Maybe that's a topic we can come back on, because the whole value chain needs to work, not just the innovation piece. Right. And but the interpretation of the images, I mean, some years ago with a university in, I believe it was in Qatar, we developed an algorithm to screen tuberculosis automatically. And actually, it had a pretty good, decent rate, but I'm not aware that we made money on it. So it didn't scale, really. So you need to find the right sweet spot for AI to become really successful.
What makes me super excited about AI is to see how it could add value in various fields in the past years, in ways that I could not have imagined a decade ago. So now there are like every other month, there are groundbreaking research papers coming out where I'm blown away by because of the idea and the new features they bring. And it's truly inspiring for me. And then to, as Philips, to give it a thought, which elements can we take from this research advances to actually provide...
But do you think we are going fast enough?
Good question. No, I think we should go faster. And I think there are elements, also key ingredients for AI to make us go faster. And we have to think also about solutions that we put in place on the healthcare side so that, for example, we will get very good annotations, stronger labels from clinical experts that we will learn real time from them, because naturally it's not in their workflow now. So let's think smartly about artificial solutions interfaces that we can at the same time get good annotations while even enhancing their routine so that they will provide better value in
and
the end.
Moreover, I think to your earlier point, we can only go so fast because maybe not all the hospitals are ready for the innovation that we're bringing. I mean, I've seen that with doctors not always implementing the technology that we bring immediately because they've been doing things such a long time.
Let's go a bit deeper on that, right? What are the impediments for adoption? So first of all, you already mentioned it needs to fit in the workflow, right? As a standalone application, it's probably not going to be easily adopted. Mm-hmm. But then if you want to embed AI in the workflow, it means you need to replace an existing process or application. That means you need to disrupt the way the hospital has designed their architecture. Right? That means you need to go to the CIO of the hospital rather than just the radiologist. And in today's hospitals that are consolidating, the rules to change the IT in the hospital become more difficult every day. Right? In fact, the CIO, they are very cautious for all the innovations that some thought-leading doctors want to put in their ecosystem because they are afraid that, you know, it may attract WannaCry or it may disrupt their stability. And therefore, just placing a cool application in that hospital IT ecosystem is not simple. And it will require convincing the C-suite, it will require doing change management, and many other things.
That's completely true. In the end, we have to have the value in mind. So in the beginning, I agree with you, there may be very small steps that we would take together in a co-creation way of working with the healthcare providers. And in the end, we will have in mind that we want to create much more value for them. So I think this mindset will change as well towards how we will be able to use AI and what AI will enable them to do. At once, maybe the radiologist will just be able to tap on an image and then the report will be generated in a structured way where he can correct when he needs to. There are some flows that maybe then be so much easier and add value that we should try to be the entrepreneur here to try to bring that across.
But rather than pushing technology for technology's sake, we will have to explain to all the decision makers at the customer, you know, how it will drive value for them. Right? And that is why at Philips we have now adopted the value-based healthcare or the so-called quadruple aim thinking of better outcomes, for health outcomes, productivity, patient experience, and staff experience. If we can package our AI applications in a way that they tick the box on all four and quantify that, then we have a way to accelerate adoption. Like the two examples where I gave, you know, in patient care and in radiology operations.
So talking about those aims that you just mentioned and the earlier mentioned resistance that you might feel from hospitals, do you think that some of that resistance may come by the thought that AI might replace like human roles in hospitals? Is that something that you envision? What's your thoughts there?
I think that may be part of it. And you know, we have all our carefully orchestrated messages, but still some roles will be affected, right? Whether we like it or not. Let's say, take an example of one of our latest innovations, which is the smart camera system in the bore of the MR, right? That will actually make sure that the image is acquired at the right time when the patient is completely inhaled and therefore has the highest chest volume, and the image will then have a higher quality. That used to be done by an operator putting a respiratory belt on, and therefore there was a person there assisting the image acquisition. Through AI and automation, that may not be necessary anymore. In other words, what used to take an extra person in the image acquisition process may actually be done without that person. Now, I think what the hospital then can do is to say, rather than having people on these tasks, we can free up those people and provide that capacity for better patient care. And then I think that is a more useful investment of that capacity. So it would be a mistake to say that the jobs of people won't be affected. I think they will, right? But that doesn't mean that there is going to be less employment in hospitals, because we can then shift, hospitals will shift capacity to more valuable or more impactful roles. And that, I think, is like any company where we change our makeup, right, our how we are constituted, that will happen to hospitals as well. So I do think that AI will have a pervasive impact on how everybody works.
So do you think then that nurses will become data analysts, or do you still think that human touch part is important in healthcare as well?
Everybody in healthcare complains about the fact that they're data analysts, right? Because they have, what the EMR, the electronic medical record, has done is they have shifted time away from the patient to do data entry, mm-hmm. which is wasteful time, and to do data retrieval, which is also wasteful time. So here is a great example where AI will make people's lives better, because we can automate the data entry, and for example, by connecting everything and integrating it, and have like bots insert the data at the right application automatically, and so that you get a mission briefing, and we use this expression at Philips, a mission briefing for the radiologist, or a mission briefing for the chief nursing officer. How are my patients doing? Mm. Right? And then we can, through AI, make sure that when a patient needs help, automatically that patient comes up. So data interpretation is then also facilitated. Now, mm-hmm. now this nurse does not have to worry about, oh, I need to go through all the data, oh, I'm backlogged about data entry, I need to sit in my office, because she can have the assurance that that is being taken care of, and moreover, he or she will get alerted when the patients are trending the wrong way, and therefore freeing up their time and taking away stress. Yeah. So I think it is a great promise.
You had a question about this too, yeah.
I could imagine that in developing countries, AI can even play a larger role and empower nurses, as you say, even more. Because there, you can think of remote areas where you don't have the resources to put specialists. So you may think of just having a nurse and a small medical center. But AI nowadays can actually screen for tuberculosis at a comparable accuracy as a human expert. So yeah. There we could put AI in place to empower.
I agree with you. I mean, I think China is going to leapfrog in this area.
Yeah, I think
right?
so
because,
too.
Because China is in a stage of development where the population is aging. Right, we are creeping towards 40, 50 years of average age. And cardiovascular disease, COPD, lung cancer, liver cancer, it will all explode. And there is no capacity in the rural hospitals to deal with these patients. And exactly. therefore, in the China 2030 healthcare strategy, the notion of teleradiology, teleoncology, whereby specialist centers can assist remote care centers to diagnose, to treat, where much mm-hmm. of that process can be automated. And even the LINAC can be auto-programmed for delivery of the radiotherapy in a more automated way, I think all of this is going to happen. Yeah. Maybe they're faster than in the Western world.
About that data and the generation of data, I mean, not only because their GDPR looks different, but also because they're just with much more people in China. And within AI, we know that the amount of data, the quality of data that you have is determining, I think, in the end, which organization will win in this space. How do you see that? What's your vision within Philips?
Well, it scares me a bit because I think you're absolutely spot on that the way we think about privacy, but moreover about the use of data in Europe, is putting us at a relative disadvantage. Yeah. Right? So yes, we need to respect privacy, but privacy can be respected even when we have curated data sets that are, for example, anonymized, but available at large scale so that we can data mine that. Today, that's not possible across Europe. In Germany, it's not even possible across states, right? Whereas in China, we get these large data lakes.
Yeah.
Right? There's even a government policy on which you can then train your algorithm.
So it scares you, but what do you do? I mean, what is the vision for your employees here to how to cope with that? What are we going to do about
that? Well, near term, we need to be practical and go where the data is.
So we're all going to China.
So we need to go and find the curated data sets and work with our academic partners wherever they are. And we are unlocking data sets as we speak. Of course, also in Europe, we are engaged with governments to help explain this. But it is a concern. And it may be why, in the next 10 years, we will find some medical research will excel in other regions.
Yeah, I really hope so, because I think data privacy and security is one of the issues that we should solve or address in very short term. You mentioned China. We can also see in top journals there are publications coming up. China is advancing a lot. And if we want to break through and accelerate, we really need to tackle this. At research in our department, we're also having projects that are trying to tackle this from a technological point of view, so to look at methods that are performing privacy-preserving data analytics.
Yeah.
So this is also a way to go. But of course, it's much better if we get the volume, because with AI, we want to go from volume to value.
Yeah. But right? Let's, as an industry, as a company, but also as an industry, we should not put ourselves in the victim mode. Right? So let's be proactive about it. I like the way you described that we can be part of the solution, where we can have AI routines even help anonymize data in a curated fashion. Also, a recent acquisition that we did, 4Care, is unlocking databases, because let's not only focus on the privacy aspect. Let's say in many hospitals, data is extremely siloed and scattered, right? And just making data accessible across all the pockets where they are, we need to come with tools, and is one of the Philips strategies, of course, to deliver these suites of health IT applications that can be a layer across all the separate databases, so that we create an integrated and holistic approach to data, and then also have the meaningful data sets that can be used for training our algorithms.
And what do you think needs to happen at Philips so that we can be the leader in AI-enabled healthcare?
Good question. Well, we need people like you, but that's not enough, because so by way of numbers, so we have shifted quite a large proportion of our R&D investment from systems to software, and now from software to data science. And we have, I don't know, 400, 500 data scientists, but we also need to train our marketeers. Understanding the insights of what application, what problem are we solving? Earlier we spoke about translating that insight into benefit against the quadruple aim. In other words, there's an economic value case for the AI application. And then walking down the value stream, we need to have the commercial people engaging with the C-suite of the hospital to be able to convey that value proposition and convince the CIO to put it in their network. And so all of that needs to evolve side by side. If I may give an example of an innovation that I'm really excited about, and that is such an ecosystem play. Right? And I mean, there are startups here in the room. How do we get everybody to collaborate on a platform? Right? I think the platform approach will facilitate and speed up adoption. What I'm referring to is IntelliSpace Discovery. It's an AI collaboration platform with where we take care of unlocking all the data sources and then have APIs so that scientists, hospitals, we ourselves, startups, can build AI applications on top of that curated platform, which I think is an answer to the CIO, because now he gets a stable, renowned platform from Philips on which you can put your AI apps and experiments. It can tap into the vast creative world of people that want to either be a startup or academic hospitals that want to develop AI algorithms. And we can put it on that platform and through our app store and make it accessible to people in the clinical use. Mm-hmm. So I think that that is probably the best of all worlds, where we bring everything together. And it also avoids that you need to sell every app separately, right? Because that is not a very economical effort. But if we have this platform approach, I think we can go faster. This came out of Philips research, so do you recognize this example?
Yeah, I think it is a very good example that you give. And I'm in a horizontal project. I'm leading the AI project for personal health. And I think it's really important there as well to always look at scalability. And although we are picking up very specific projects to help our businesses and customers, we always have in the back of our mind, how can we reuse that for the next business? So I think this is really touching the very important point. And I would like to mention also what you said earlier, that customer intimacy is very important. So we should not just be at Philips Research and pushing our technology over a bridge, but we should be connecting with the customer and understanding their true needs, because only then we can develop meaningful innovation. So from volume to value, it's not just about getting a lot of data, because then you still don't know how to create value, right? You still need to understand what is it that you need to extract out of there.
Well, and we heard Mark van Buchem talking about how he also wants to contribute in advancing science and put it in clinical use.
Yeah.
And a platform approach like this that stretches from on the one hand, the research world, to the other hand, a clinical setting with compliant applications that can solve that. Yeah. And I think that is pretty exciting.
Yeah, I think so too. In view of time, let me wrap up with a final question, which I am very curious to hear your view on, which is, why do you think that Philips will be thousands of companies offering AI solutions in healthcare?
I'm very confident that we can win. And I already have given some of the reasons why. I've, for example, spoken about the fact that every AI startup just solves this little piece of what is that kind of a healthcare problem. I've spoken about CIOs not wanting to allow all these little applications in their architecture because that's too scary for them. They need to have a reputable platform approach that is stable and tested and FDA compliant and everything. And so we've spoken about the need to have a educated go-to-market organization that can also provide support. We have had startups who work with us on IntelliSpace Discovery say that they can actually take 2 years away from the time to market by working with us.
Yeah.
Because now they don't need to make the whole stack, but rather they can focus on the value-added application that fits on that curated platform. So I think we need startups. Startups need us. This is also why Philips wants to have an open platform approach where we can can reinforce each other. And I think it's the crowdsourcing way, right? This is where we work together.
What about the personal health part of Philips? Because we are generating actually lots of data from all our daily activities, sensors, wearable sensors, smartphones around us that can complement the healthcare data, which is very episodic and coarse. Do you see also opportunities there for Philips to play a leading role? Because we have both, right? We have professional healthcare and personal health.
Our strategy is anchored on the premise that we can bridge between the hospital and the home. Right? And in some product categories, we are already quite successful at that.
Yeah.
Think about sleep and respiratory care, where we have 5 million patients connected through the cloud to our enterprise systems, where we can take the data overnight, interpret it, give coaching back to the patient, but also leverage the data to demonstrate compliance to the payer and give feedback to the doctor. So we are facilitating a triangular system between patient, provider, and doctor.
That's very strong, Philips.
It's a very strong example. Now, I would like to see similar examples in other areas. I think we are starting to. I mean, the Sonicare for kids, right, which is the toothbrush for kids. Now, we all remember from our youth, where your mom said, did you brush your teeth? And everybody said, yeah, I did. Well, maybe you didn't. But with a connected toothbrush, where we use gamification to actually engage the child in the brushing experience, teaching them to brush well. And by the way, we can tell mom that the kid did brush, is for me a first kind of, you know, different user experience that is connected, where AI plays a role and data plays a role. But if we are honest, of course, we still have much to do before the quantified self happens in front of the bathroom mirror, right? Because that is what I think should be our vision, right? Where we can quantify your health when you wake up in the morning and say, hey, I look good today. Yeah. Maybe there's a few indicators off, right? And then... you take an extra
We are working
pill.
On that.
You are working on that. All right, cool.
I think we would love to continue talking, but...
it was great having a chat with you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And let's make this together successful.